just afraid to change.
Change.
Change. We need to change things up.
It's a show about change. Welcome to Bob's Basement. Here's your host, Bob Ouellette.
Thank you very much, Mr. Big Voice Guy. Welcome to Bob's Basement, Episode 3. My name is Bob Ouellette. I am your host from my basement. This episode with Nadia Lloyd, a Toronto artist and entrepreneur, just a phenomenal person to speak to, was recorded a couple days after the American election. I'm going to say the Thursday. So about a week ago from when I'm recording these intros for this particular show. So I wanted to give you that heads up if it seems a little out of date. There's a few references to the American election in there. And this was before CNN called it for Joe Biden. So just wanted to give you that heads up. Also wanted to let you know that, you know, part of my idea of how to bring this podcast about the concept of change to life was to have inspirational quotes about change and, you know, discuss those with you and maybe get your feedback via Twitter or email or whatever. The problem is most of these quotes, they're fine. I can't get past the Pinteresty style, the things that, you know, it should be a decal on a wall, you know, the live, laugh, love thing. And God bless you if you have it. That's fine. It's okay. Live, laugh, love is a wonderful way of looking at things. However, when you just Google, you know, quotes about change, you get 32 awesome quotes to inspire positive change. And it's like, so this, you know, this guy who's like the vice president of executive development at Walmart put these quotes together. But of course, somebody then goes and takes them and puts them on some weird background with a flower in it. Anyhow, I'm still working on that part of the show. What the meat of the of this show is talking to other people about their experience with change and the lessons that they've learned. So let's get right to it. This is Nadia Lloyd, Toronto artist, Toronto entrepreneur, producer, all kinds of things. Take a listen. I hope you enjoy. Welcome to Bob's Basement Podcast. My name is Bob Ouellette. I appreciate your time. Joining me in my basement, virtually, of course, is Nadia Lloyd. She is an artist, a designer, entrepreneur, event planner. And Nadia, first of all, thank you so much for taking time to come on my podcast.
My pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Nadia Lloyd came into, I would say, a lot of our lives over the course of the last year. You're a Torontonian, you're from Toronto. You came up in my Twitter feed, I will admit, probably the first time around the bubble playoffs for the NBA. Nick Nurse started wearing your masks that you designed. So that's how we don't know each other. So I want to thank you very much. I reached out to you just as a stranger online and you've agreed to do this. So I am very appreciative of that. Thank you.
My pleasure.
So let's go back, because this is a podcast about change and you've been a designer and an artist for a long time. I get the feeling that you've probably experienced some pretty significant change in the last year.
Yeah. I think I would say I've experienced change my whole life, because first I was in broadcasting like you, then I became a personal trainer, then I became an artist, then I became a designer, then I became an event planner. So I tend to kind of pursue my passions and, you know, roll with the punches. This year has been exceptional in terms of, you know, going from an artist designer to a mask maker and seeing my BLM mask on Nick Nurse and my Canada and Pride mask on Mayor Tory almost on a daily basis for months on end. It was incredible.
Do you know how the mayor got, because was he the first public figure that kind of, yeah. Do you know how the mayor got the Pride mask?
I do. So sometime in June, right before my birthday, I got a message on Instagram and it said, "Hi, I'm writing to you from the mayor's office. We really like your Pride mask and we'd like to get him some." And I said, "Great." And then they said, "We're having some technical issues with shipments. Could we come pick it up?" I said, "Sure, you can come, you know, this afternoon. Here's my cell number. Call me when you're ready." And at 5 o'clock, I got a text that said, "We're downstairs." And And here I was thinking it was like her and her coworker or something like that. And then made it down to the lobby and the mayor stood up and he said, "Are you Nadia Lloyd?" I said, "Yes." He said, "I'm Mayor Tory." I said, "I know who you are." Even though his face was covered, I'd seen him on TV, you know, 10 of minutes course. Earlier. Yeah. And he said, "We were looking for a pride mask. And then lo and behold, we came across yours on Instagram, which is the pride mask featuring the Toronto skyline. And I had to have it right away. And I had to come and meet you and tell you how much I love your work."
That's amazing. Isn't it amazing how one person's influence could change things so quickly?
Yeah, absolutely. And I did see, you know, an influx in media interviews and sales after he started wearing my masks. And in fact, for Canada Day, I had designed a Canada mask with him in mind. But his office had said to me, "We already have all of his Canada mask day picked out, but you know, we'll come and pick it up because it's nice and he'll probably wear it eventually." And then he ended up wearing pretty much my mask alone on Canada Day. And he went on breakfast television in the morning and he talked about me and my work. And it was just like, can this get any better, right? And then the Raptors.
I want to pause. Because I do want to talk about the Raptors. I'm a huge Raptors fan, and I think like most of us in Toronto, just so proud of that team and the way they stood up for BLM, and they led that charge in the NBA. It was unbelievable. But I want to pause because I want to go back. You said something, and I picked up. I should have said something earlier. You talked about how you have changed a lot throughout your life, and you've gone from being a broadcaster and a whole bunch of other things, and you've kind of gone where your heart has taken you. You know, one of the things that is different about the world we live in now compared to the world that maybe our parents grew up in or our grandparents is people change careers 6 times on average now. Not just job. They don't just play, you know, I go from working from one insurance company to another insurance company. They completely shift gears and go to something else. And you've done that. Would you care? Do you have any perspective? Do you have any stories you'd like to offer? Like, what I'm in the middle of a change. The reason I'm doing this, I'm a broadcaster. I'm in between jobs, quote unquote, but I've been 22 years in radio and I may have to change. You know, here I am now in this basement doing this show, keeping my name out there. And I love it. I love doing this. I love booking guests and talking to different people, but I may have to change. What's your first significant change you kind of remember maybe career-wise in your life?
It was when I was in broadcasting school. So I got into a program at Centennial, and I think out of 1,700 applicants, 26 were accepted, and I was one of them. Wow. And I was very excited to get in because since I was a teenager, I was doing a lot of work with the media. I was modeling, I was acting, I was broadcasting shows on TVO. Like, I was hosting them, I was co-hosting them, I was doing production, I was doing research. So I'd had my hands in there, you know, for quite a while. So I was really excited to get into the program, but something happened in my second year when we started doing internships in the industry. And I realized that really I was being treated like, you know, like nothing. It was like, I was here, I was working with a publicist at one point and she would send me on coffee and tea runs and give me, you know, jobs that really wouldn't be teaching me anything in the industry. And we were working on a TV show 12, 18 hours a day. And I was speaking to other production assistants who had just graduated from my program and were entering the industry. And they were telling me it's like 12 hour days at $8 an hour. And I'm an entrepreneur to begin with. And really what I loved about broadcasting and what I wanted to do was to shoot documentaries based on topics that interested me. And so it's something that I would have done for free, you know, but to get coffee and tea all day, that wasn't really aligned with my plans. So in my second year of broadcasting, coincidentally, like every other career that I've entered into, it's been by accident. I started working out because I put on 15 pounds in my first 2 years, lost the weight, felt amazing, decided, hey, you know what? I could be a personal trainer, make $35 to $60 an hour. Like, forget broadcasting. I'm going into fitness. And so before I graduated from broadcasting, I started doing personal training certifications. And so I still finished my degree in broadcasting. But right the following September, I started a program, a fitness anatomy program at Seneca. And then I was a personal trainer for 13 years. So I would say that was the first major change, because everyone was looking at me like, you've been in this for 15 years and all of a sudden you're a personal trainer. What's going on? But I always knew since I was a kid that, you know, it never made sense to me that people were working the same career for 45 years unless they loved it. And I knew a lot of people didn't love what they were doing, but they just kept going. And to me, that never made sense. It was like, my number one priority is to be happy. And if that means that I have to turn my world upside down to make it happen, well, that's going to have to happen and it's going to hurt for a bit. But the goal is to find happiness and to, you know, now I'm an artist. So now I realize that all of these things culminated to being an artist. And when you're an artist, you lead with your heart. And now that I understand that, it's fine. I'll keep rolling with the punches as long as I can stay happy.
It takes a lot of bravery. It takes, because I think those people that stay in the same job for a long time, when they're unhappy, even they're on, I think they're just afraid to make that leap, right? They're afraid. It's the unknown that makes it so hard to do. Were there any moments where you maybe I shouldn't have done this? You know, at a certain point, you're like, did you make some decisions along the way that you were like, you know what, this isn't right now?
100%. Like, you know, they say when you're an entrepreneur, people think that you go from start to success in a straight line, but it's actually like, it's almost like reading an EKG on EKG?
EKG,
on
heart monitor, yeah, sure.
Yeah, so no, you have great moments, you have bad moments, you have great days, you have bad days, you question yourself, you question life, you question everything, but, you know, as long as the you keep your goal in mind and you keep focused on that, then you'll remember that life is not easy and it does come with its challenges, and, you know, things will get in your way to challenge your determination and your integrity. And so that's kind of how I just am able to overcome the difficulties and just keep going towards the goal.
Do you have a good support network? Do you have good friends, family to help you through things? Or are you kind of a lone wolf?
I'm a lone wolf, but I'm 45 now. And I have to say, like, what I love to hear is when I do make these changes in careers without saying a word to anyone. And all of a sudden my friends are like, you know, like I remember my sister-in-law one day saying, oh my God, you're an artist now. And I've been on your website and your art is incredible. Like, when did that happen? So, you know, that's one thing a lot of my friends and my family have said that's true to my character, that they see that I'm resilient and that I'm a go-getter, and that if I'm focused and passionate, nothing can get in my way. I'll get it done. And honestly, I get it done on my own. Like, I've never gotten a bank loan to help me do something. I've never asked for help. I just kind of, it's the Gemini in me. I love to just explore and discover and see what happens. What's the worst that can happen?
Well, yeah, you know what? And you're right. When you look at it that way, what is the worst that can happen? I think what happens is people think I could end up penniless and without a job. And I've been, you talked about we're at the same age, and you talk about being a PA for $8 an hour. I started off here in Toronto at CFNY, on the edge, producing the weekend live-to-air club gigs for $8 an hour. It's so funny you say that. And doing the exact same thing, while the host and the DJ were making hundreds and hundreds of dollars, but I was the guy lugging the boxes up the stairs into smoky DJ booths. But it builds character. It teaches you that it's gonna be worth the effort, you know?
Yeah, and you know what else it teaches you? You can't figure out what you want unless you figure out what you don't want. And so, you know, the last 45 years, that's kind of helped me navigate life too. It's like, okay, I know I don't want this. So, but what is it that I do want? And it helps you, you know, figure it out.
I've always said it is so much easier to know what you don't want. I think it's easier. I don't want that. But to know what you want, and I've been very lucky to be passionate about about broadcast, about media my whole life. So I like it. I wouldn't mind spending another 20 years in broadcast in some capacity. And that would put me at 40 plus years in the same industry, at least. I like it. It makes it, it's still, now maybe that might change someday, but it makes me happy. Let me ask we'll go back to the Pride Mass just for a second, because I was the program director for 103.9 Proud FM for 8 years here in Toronto, the gay radio station, and my involvement in the gay community was, and I'm still a staunch ally of the gay community, but my time there is probably some of the best moments in my life, seeing and helping the radio station and thrive for quite a while. How have your masks been received? I know the mayor loved it. How were your masks received by the community?
Super well, and right out of the gates. Like, I remember posting a little video on Instagram when I sold the first one and could physically hold it in my hands. I put it on my face, and I did a little little panning video to show, you know, to show the skyline, and my caption said something like, "Oh yeah, I'm doing this." Yeah. Like, it's been super well received from day one. And it was really fun in June to get lots of photos from people of different walks of life in different industries, different races, wearing the mask, tagging me, sending me photos, sending me testimonials. And in fact, I mean, I shipped a bunch this morning when I was fulfilling my orders. So it's still selling. Yeah. And the thing that I realized is that I've created a collection with my four masks, you know, the Canada Toronto collection. So it has the Pride mask, the Canada mask, the black and white classic skyline design, and the BLM Toronto mask. And those are really four masks that are like conversation starters, and they are my best sellers. And I'm so proud of the conversations that they create when people are wearing them out there, and people are constantly messaging me and tagging me and sharing all of these great stories with me.
Let's talk about before the mask thing, because this is such a new thing. You were an artist and you were doing prints on just clothes, like you were doing workout pants and t-shirts and I assume, and this just from a business standpoint, was that a sustainable action? Like, was that sustainable for you as an artist? Because it's so hard to be a living, working artist.
It is, yeah. Well, so for me, because I'm an entrepreneur, I tend to start businesses. So in 2013, I launched an event planning company called Toronto Art Crawl. And so I've been running large-scale art exhibits for the last 7 years. And I do between 5 and 7 a year, and they feature between 60 and 120 artists per event. So that was the bulk of my livelihood the last 7 years. It was also the bulk of my full-time work. So really my art and my design was my passion project. Running the events was my job. And you know, in March of 2020, someone turned off the faucet, and that was the end of that. And so, yeah, so that was incredibly scary. And like everyone else, I didn't have, you know, any information as to how I was going to survive and sustain myself being self-employed. And it was by sheer gift from heaven that one day I said to my son, why don't we cut up some of my cushion covers with my art printed and make face masks? Because I had ordered a box on online, but it was going to take forever to arrive. And so I sold two hand masks. Sorry, I hand sold two masks for ourselves to wear. We went out for a walk on a Sunday afternoon. We went to the CN Tower. We took some photos. I posted online. And that is how this entire face mask journey began. Posted photos, people went bananas. They started asking, where can I buy this? I was like, I don't have any more of the Toronto fabric, but I do have a ton of cushion covers with my art printed, beautiful art. And I was getting requests from doctors and nurses asking, can you donate face masks? My hospital is in dire need. My unit is in dire need. And that's when I started cutting up my cushion covers and repurposing them into face masks to make donations. And I was making donations of 60 to 100 a week. Fast forward, you know, six weeks or so, and I realized that people are still asking to buy these, and I'm starting to spend a lot of money on supplies, and I got no money coming in except for CERB for the first couple of months.
Right.
So I started selling the masks, and the rest is history.
Are you now? Do you have a team? Are you like? Are you like? How many people help you
now
make these?
I do now. So I would say that up until I can't remember exactly, but up until mid July, I was doing all of the sewing. But once the photos of Nick Nurse and Fred VanVleet came out, it was game over. Like, I touched my machine twice ever since, you know. I had to put together a team really quickly to keep up with the orders because people were ordering and they wanted them like yesterday. Yeah. So at one point I had 5 tailors around Toronto, and every day I would have to cut up a ton of fabric in my studio, get in my car, drive the fabric over to these guys, get them to sew. 5 p.m. I would get in my car again, go pick them up, come back to the studio, fulfill. And I realized quickly, like, I'm going to go nuts. Like, this is not sustainable. I'm working 15 hours a day. I'm exhausted, but I'm on adrenaline. So I'm not even feeling the exhaustion, but I know I'm exhausted, right? And so in August, I started looking for a factory that could handle it all. And luckily, I found one. And they not only sew the masks for me based on my specifications, but they also print my art.
Wow.
So now the whole operation is local, which makes me feel really great.
Let's talk about that design, the BLM. It is such a powerful image you put together there. The colors, the simplicity of it. Where did that come from?
So my son and I designed it together. It was really our first collaboration in terms of design. We paint together all the time, but it was the first time we designed something together. And luckily for me, ended up being, you know, the biggest thing that I ever put out to the world. So I'm super proud. So the design was born out of you know, a lot of sadness, fear, anger over George Floyd being murdered. So he was murdered at the end of May. And for a few weeks there, it was like I was knocked off my chair. Like I just didn't feel good. I relived a lot of the racism that I've suffered. And I knew I had to talk with my 9-year-old about all this. But it took me 2 weeks to work up the courage. And finally, when I came up with the courage, I sat him down and him and I had a chat. We had a good chat. He asked questions. I answered. I asked questions. He answered. And at the end of the conversation, to this day, neither of us knows who brought it up first. But one of us said, what if we design a BLM mask? Because by then I had started to actually create new designs for my face mask because I was running out of these cushion covers. So I took the opportunity to start designing, right, and having some fun. And the next day we were at the computer putting the design together. And I remember, you know, what color should we make it? Well, I'm black and white. I love the contrast of black, white, and gray. Why don't we make it black, white, and gray so that it reflects who we are? We're multicultural, so we're going to pick those 3 colors and we're going to keep it sort of, you know, simple and relative to what the message is. And then we knew it had to have the skyline of Toronto because that's my muse and it's on 99% of what's on my website. And it was also meant to create a visual of not just the BLM fist, which everybody recognizes, the fist of solidarity, but tied into the Toronto skyline, meaning like our city coming together to recognize, you know, the multiculturalism, to talk about racism, to share our stories and our experiences so we can hopefully create change. And so I sent the design to print. It came in on July the 9th. I was super excited to get the material. Right away, like within minutes, I cut it up and sewed a face mask. And then I had the face mask in hand and I was just like, wow, I can't wait to see what this mask is going to do.
Well, it did a lot. It did. Yeah. It's still doing a lot. It's amazing. You just said something that really resonated with me. You said that the Toronto skyline is your muse, but you also said that you've experienced racism and here in the city. And, you know, sometimes we like to pride ourselves a little too much as Canadians that, oh, we're not like them. We're not like them. How do you deal with that dichotomy? Those two things of the city of Toronto being your muse. And I grew up in the east of Toronto. In an Ontario housing project, I am a Torontonian through and through. I love this city so much, but it's not perfect. How does that manifest itself in you?
Well, you know what? To be honest, most of most of my experiences with racism came from Montreal, and came from small cities in Ontario. Not so much from Toronto. So I remember an incident in Huntsville when my husband and I went to spend a weekend at a cottage, and we went into a local mom and pop restaurant to have lunch. And the minute we walked in, it was like the record scratched. Everybody just stopped eating. They were all staring at us. And I didn't right away realize what was going on. And my husband leaned over and he was like, do you see what's going on here? And I was like, no. He's like, they're staring at us because we're biracial. And I was like, really? Like, that's how naive I am all the time, thinking, you know, because I spread love. So I'm thinking, you know, everyone does the same. And I was like, oh, shit, you're right. And he said, do you want to leave? And I said, hell no. We came here to eat. They can watch me eat for an hour if they want. I don't care, right? But yeah, if I go back into my history, I remember at 6 years old being called the N-word on the playground by kids. Ugh. But I remember their parents referring to my sister and I, because we grew up in a predominantly Caucasian neighborhood. And I remember the parents referring to us as the little nigger girls. Oh. So all of that was accepted. You know, I mean, fair enough, it was the early 80s. But in my mid-teens, I went back to Montreal to visit family. I was followed in a pharmacy. The staff thought that I was going to steal. So it's all of these, like, what do they call it? Microaggressions, yep. These experiences that, you know, individually don't have much impact, but when they all hit you at once, like they did after George Floyd was murdered, they all hit me at once. And that's when I was like, oh man, you know, I've been in denial because I've never seen the big picture, and it's not pretty and it's bullshit.
To say the least. And as we are recording, might as well say this now, we are literally waiting for the presidential election to finish. This is the Thursday morning, and we're trying to figure out what the hell's going on. And, you know, and Black Lives Matter is a big part of that. And even if Joe Biden does win, my goodness, what a indictment on that country. Right?
I know. It's like we can't really win with this election.
No.
Because the threat of violence and repercussion is so huge either way that it's heartbreaking to see how divided the U.S. is.
It had to be a landslide for Biden to kind of rejuvenate any kind of positive feelings to have about that country. It had to be.
Exactly.
And it's not. It's way too close. There's way too much divisiveness and, let's face it, just blatant racism and misogyny. Yeah. It's horrible.
And Trump is still fueling the hate.
Yeah. No, it's true. And it's you said, you know, you're one who likes to spread love. So, you know, unfortunately, that culminates for you in the death of George Floyd, and kind of, you know, using as an artist, obviously using your own experience, culminates and turns itself into this powerful image that you put on this mask. Now, the good part of it, you put the mask together, you make it. How does Fred VanVleet or Nick Nurse of the Raptors, how do they get it? What happens?
Okay, so remember how I said on July the 9th, I got my fabric and I cut up the first mask?
Sure.
So I'd been in my studio working that day. And after I had the mask in hand, I went and sat on my balcony to take a break. It was like 5 o'clock dinner time. And like everyone else, I mindlessly jump on Facebook. And I come across a post by BlogTO featuring the new Raptors buses in Florida, featuring Black Lives Matter from start to finish. And right away, my instinct just said, I have to get these to the Raptors.
Yeah, of course. Like, sure.
I don't know how, but I have to get these to the Raptors. And so I jumped online on the Facebook Liberty Village page where I live. And I knew that Nick Nurse used to live in Liberty Village. I didn't know if he was still here or not, him and his family. But I jumped on the Liberty page and I posted a photo of the buses and my mask. And I said, I'm just about to release this new design, donating $5 to BLM. I'd love to find a way to donate one of each to the Raptors players. Can anyone put me in touch? And I put the phone aside and went back to work. And 2 hours later, I picked up the phone again, went back to the post to see if I had any traction. I'd received like great feedback, beautiful design, good work, you go girl, I'm ordering some, you know, all that kind of stuff. But I did see one comment that had 19 likes, and it came from a Roberta Nurse, and it said, check your DMs. And in my head, I'm like, no. So I check my DMs, and sure enough, she says, hi, Nadia, I'm Roberta, Nick Nurse's wife. And just wanted to let you know that we absolutely love your work. We love what you're doing. We love what you stand for. And there's no way that we're accepting a donation on this. We want to order 35 for all of the players and management.
Wow. I get chills with you telling me. It's unbelievable.
It was amazing. And so she said, she gave me her cell number, said, you know, let me know when they're ready. We'll arrange for a pickup so I can ship them out to Nick, who's in Florida right now. And so 2 weeks later, I had them ready. My son and I drove out to her house. My son hung out with her sons for 5-10 minutes while her and I chatted outside. And she said to me, you know, every time I've talked to Nick this week, he's been like, have you shipped them? He's really excited to get them. I couldn't even believe that. And then she said, look, like we can't promise anything, right? Hopefully you'll get a couple of pictures. We can't promise anything. And I was like, absolutely. Even one picture would be amazing. And then fast forward to July 27th, Monday night, the Raptors virtual conference. She sends me a text at 5 o'clock and says, Nick and Fred are about to go on this virtual conference wearing your mask. If I come across any photos, I'll let you know. Well, you know, within 3 seconds, my Twitter blew up.
Sure.
Because Blake Murphy posted a photo and said, mask by Nadia Lloyd. And it was like, that's when the insanity in my world began, like in the most beautiful way. I remember just looking at Twitter. It was like I was at a casino. I'd never seen my Twitter do that before. Like,
ding, 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 ding.
Every time I refresh, and I was watching the numbers like a slot machine just spinning. And I was like, I remember my sister calling me and she was asking questions. And I was like, what's my name? Like, you're asking me questions. I don't even know what my name is right now. What's going on? Like, it was a total out of body experience, and it was incredible.
This is like such a rarity. This is an example of social media for good, right? Like, you
amazing,
know, you use social media to reach out, and then finding it all out on social media when there's, you know, it's quite often, let's face it, social media is a bit of a cesspool, right? Most of the time, people are hiding behind their keyboards or their phones or whatever. That is phenomenal. So you've now had to, that changed everything for you.
Yeah.
It's hard work. It's a little bit of luck. It's creativity, obviously.
Yeah. Trusting your instinct, right? Like when that idea came that I had to get it to the Raptors, I could have easily said, okay, that was crazy, back to whatever I'm doing. But I've got this like passion and drive where the idea popped in my head and I was like, I got to make it happen. And I'm not shy about asking for help. Like, it's got to happen. It was just such a strong intuition, you know?
It's I know what you're saying. I've kind of gone through this with putting this podcast together of going, why limit myself about who I can ask to come on my show to talk about change? Don't limit myself. Like, okay, I'll ask people, what's the worst they're going to say? No, or ignore me. That's it, you know?
Exactly.
That's no, they have no power.
You're no better off or worse off.
Yeah.
Right?
No, it's true. If they say no, then okay, fine, whatever. If they ignore me, it's like it never happened. But they might say yes. And if they do, then it's, you know, it's good for my creative process and all that. It really is a great way to live. If you can live with that kind of positive outlook and not allowing the outside influences really affect who you are as a human being, I think it makes things a lot easier. So what's next for Nadia Lloyd? What is going, like, I mean, I'm sure you're still writing this. You've got a factory. So you have a factory here in Toronto that's making your stuff now?
Just outside of the city.
Good.
Yeah. And it's been great. Like, they were able to, you know, to start helping me right away, even though they also had to revisit their business model because they lost a lot of business since March. And so I think they quickly realized that they were going to get a lot of requests for sewers. And so they put a team together, they invested in the equipment, and it's been really great to work with them and know that I'm supporting another mom and pop company, you know?
Of course, yeah. I mean, the idea of being able to do something locally is so important, and when your art is so based around Toronto,
that's it.
Even before the BLM or the Pride mask, your stuff has always been with the skyline. And by the way, your stuff is beautiful. It's amazing.
Thank you.
What do you?
Thank you.
No, you're welcome. Thank you for it. what do you now? Do you find time now? Are you still making art? Are you doing new things?
Yeah, actually, it's been great since having the factory sew for me. And having, you know, built up a good reserve of inventory so that I can get back to some of the things that I love to do, like painting, for example. And I get commissioned for original art all the time. In fact, this morning, right before a call, I was getting art supplies for two commissions I'm working on. So really, it's trying to find that balance while I wait for the next blast of inspiration to come. Because a lot of people have said, what's next? And that's not really how I create and I operate. So it's more like I have little ideas brewing, you know, if they brew for 2 to 4 weeks, then I give them a voice. If they disappear, then they disappear. But also right now I'm finding that I'm still needing a lot of rest from the summer and from, from the adrenaline and from the rush and from the 15-hour days. And so I'm also, to be honest, trying to enjoy some downtime. Like,
it's exhausting.
It happened so fast. And I was like the only person driving this whole train, you know? So it really exhausted me in a lot of ways. So, and it's taken me a few weeks post the craziness to realize it. So yeah, right now I'm trying to fill up my tank by eating well, by sleeping well, by being creative, by doing things that feed my soul so that I can get ready for the next, you know, burst.
Well, and let's not forget this. There's a pandemic on, and it's mentally, emotionally, even physically exhausting for all of us, right?
So much. You're so right. And paired with the American elections too, right?
Yeah.
Like last night, it was like a train wreck. Oh. I knew that the results weren't going to be out, but I was still like on my phone, the TV going, texting here, doing this and that. And it was, and feeling like anxiety over it. And I kept reminding myself, like, first of all, the results won't be in. Second of all, like, you're getting sucked into a vortex right now that's not healthy. But yeah, it's all of these things. Like, it's not the same life as this time last October. And there's so much for our brains and our souls to get okay with,
yeah,
you know?
To compute. It's actually, every day is more exhausting than, I mean, none of, and that's why the podcast is about change, because, well, we're the same age. We've never seen any kind of change like this in our lives. Nothing like this ever. You know, we're old enough to remember the pre-internet world. That's the biggest difference, I think, in our lives, is that change of,
before phones became like surgically attached to our hands.
The idea when we were in grade 8, say, you know, in 1989 or 88 or whatever it was, when we were in grade 8, the idea of sitting in front of what this is a laptop. A computer then was this huge, like, you know, icon, or, you know, Commodore 64 or something.
Yeah.
And the ability to talk to each other and reach out to each other. So that change was gradual, right? Like,
it was
like, oh, the information superhighway, what's that? And, you know, and
exactly.
we learned about it. Now, granted, it's gotten faster and faster with these, like you said, with phones. But this change, this pandemic, and the last 4 years of the president that the United States has had, and the divisiveness of it, it's fast.
And, you know, I'm sure I'm not alone in this, but I find myself having moments where it's like, what planet am I on? Like, like, how is all of this okay? And am I dreaming? And is this a nightmare? Have I gone crazy? You know what I mean? And then, like, having to remind myself to check out a little bit, like Netflix for the next 6 hours, go out for a walk, go to sleep early, don't drink too much.
I'm proud to have been able to have virtually met you. I don't have that entrepreneurial spirit. I'm trying to right now with this, by doing this. I'm always in awe of people like yourself who have taken their situations, take the bull by the horns, as it were. And your story is just amazing.
Thank you. I'm just doing me, because that's all I can do.
Sure. Yeah.
But it always really makes me happy when I think that I can inspire and give someone else permission to pursue their own dreams, you know? Like, I remember reading a quote when I was 16 that really changed my life, and it said, "You create your own destiny or someone else will."
Yes, I've seen that actually kind of retweeted or re-Instagrammed quite a few times. It's pretty powerful stuff.
Yeah, and I was like, wow, that really resonates.
The other thing is, isn't it amazing that with a lot of hard work, a lot of luck comes along?
Yeah,
isn't it amazing
absolutely.
That good luck comes when you're working hard, right? And you're clearly a hard worker, that's for sure.
Yeah.
How do people? Okay, so NadiaLloyd.com. There's the Instagram page.
Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter are all under Nadia Lloyd TO.
Okay.
TO for Toronto.
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, and that's how you find me online.
That's how I found you, and I'm very, very fortunate for you to take the time out of your busy schedule and out of your relaxing. This was a reach out for me personally that was a little bit outside my comfort zone. As a broadcaster, I usually talk to musicians and I talk to other broadcasters on a regular basis, but your story was so compelling to me that I felt the need to reach out, and you were kind enough to say yes, so I thank you very much.
My pleasure. This was a really good chat, and it fueled my spirit and my soul too. So thank you for that. Thank you.
So there you have it. Episode 3 of Bob's Basement in the books. Thank you very much for joining me and Nadia. Nadia being on my show was a big thing to me. I've spent 22 years plus in radio as a producer, as a host, as a program director, a music director. So talking to radio people and talking to musicians is easy fodder for me. And I'm comfortable with it because I can speak their language. We speak a common language. I'm really trying, as I move forward with this podcast, to talk to people both from radio and music, of course, because I find that infinitely interesting, and I hope you do too. But I'm really trying to talk to people who are a little bit outside my my realm of knowledge. Nadia is a visual artist, a seamstress. We didn't even really talk about her skills as somebody who sews, but I want to talk to people who have done things that are different than I have. I find people and their points of view infinitely interesting when I don't share their point of view, or at least when I haven't had that common experience. And I hope that came across in that interview with Nadia, because it felt really good to speak to her. She's a wonderful speaker, and her perspective is unbelievable. And I hope you enjoyed it. I'm going to continue to talk to people from all walks of life, hopefully, whether they're in the visual arts. I mean, let's be honest, it'll probably be arts related. I might get some sports people on. I'd like to get some sports people on. I love sports, but I mean, it will be arts related for sure. I hope you continue to listen to the podcast. We're going to try to drop at least one a week. Thank you again to Frank Laritis for helping me put the final touches on these podcasts, to Mark Sylvain, who helped to do my logo. Thank you to Adam Robinson, who has graciously loaned me some fine equipment, and of course to Toronto Mike, who has also loaned me some fine equipment to put this together. So thank you all, and we'll talk to you in probably less than a week.
We gotta stop making changes.
This has been Bob's Basement. Thanks for listening.
Things change. That's the way it is.
For more information, email Bob at BobWillette@gmail.com. That's Bob Willette, like Gillette, with a W. Follow Bob on Twitter at Bob Willette. Bob's Basement is available where you find your favorite podcasts. Until next time.
Well, that's the way it is.